So I would like to introduce you, Professor Tini Tuitelas. I did not know her for long, but we cooperated in the last year or so, and I was impressed by her qualities, scientific qualities, I mean, in continual learning. And I invited her to join this AI Excellence Lecture Series. She's professor at the Catholic University of Leuven in Belgium. She's working on computer vision and in topics like image representations, vision and language, and continual learning that she's going to present today. She has been program chair in a number of conferences, like big ones like ECCV14 and CVPR 21, and she was also general chair for CVPR 2016. She was associate editor in chief for IEEE transactions on PAMI for a number of years. She got an ESC starting grant, let's say, 10 years ago. And she has received the Quandaring Test of Time Award at ECCV 2016. So, Tina, the floor is yours. You can start. By the way, before you start, as I told you, the lecture is going to be about, let's say, 45 minutes. And then please raise your hand and you can ask questions.
Okay, so Yannis, thanks for the nice introduction. Thanks for having me for this event. Thanks to the audience for joining, because indeed, like, there's a lot of online events these days. So I hope I can keep you interested during 45 minutes. It's a bit difficult because I don't really see my audience and I don't really know all your backgrounds. So what I did is I split the talk basically in two parts. I'll start with a longish introduction, really about what is continual learning, why do I think this is really a topic that you should all be more involved in. Why do we really need to go beyond the traditional setting of a lot of the work in machine learning where you just have training, validation, test? And then hopefully, if I have convinced you on that, I'll move on to the second part of the talk where I go a bit deeper in like a particular method we have developed recently in this context of continual learning. And so there's basically these two parts in the talk where the first might be like a bit obvious for some, but then the last one may be too technical for some others. So I'll try to find a balance there. Okay, so a lot of the work in AI these days is data driven. And a lot of the success of AI is because of this data driven view on AI. And that's especially for cases where it's really difficult to bring in domain knowledge. And so what does this image of this cute dog do there? It's because images are a very good example of this setting. In images, there's so much information and it's really difficult to model that explicitly, to just based on reasoning, based on our domain knowledge. You could say, okay, I have a dog. If I have like two eyes at a certain location with respect to each other, a nose, some ears, in between some texture like fur. But to come up with a model like that, that generalizes to all possible dogs that we have in the world, is really challenging. And people have tried to do that. But at some point, we all realized for complex data like images, it's so much better, so much easier to start from the data, to go for appearance-based models. And the data itself is the model. And so we just learn from the data, we detect patterns in that data, and this data-driven AI, where deep learning is the most recent implementation of, really has led to a lot of breakthroughs where now we can indeed recognize all these dogs. We can label all those images as having one thing in common, namely the fact that they're all images of dogs. At the same time, this data-driven approach also comes with certain limitations or risks. The model is only as good as the data is. And if there's any issue with the data, the model will also be affected. And that is an aspect that sometimes I feel we don't pay enough attention to. There's a couple of underlying assumptions when we talk about data-driven AI that are not always made explicit or that people consider like obvious. And the first one is that basically, whenever you do take a data-driven approach to AI, we have training data from which you learn, and we assume that this training data is representative for what you will encounter later at the test stage. And if you put it like that, people say, yeah, obviously, if you see something completely different at test time than at training time, how could the machine know what to output? Yet it's sometimes not that clear, and it's a condition that's actually harder to meet in reality than one would expect. There's a lot of cases where this doesn't happen. And so it's a point of attention. It's at least an assumption that we should be aware of, that we should be familiar with and keep in mind. The second assumption is that all training data is available all the time. In standard machine learning based approaches, we say, okay, we collect some training data and then we use that training data to train our model. And if all the data is available continuously, we have the luxury to basically go over the same data over and over again. And like multiple epochs where iteratively we refine our models and we get better and better at solving a particular task. But in practice, there's no guarantee that this is practical. So we need a lot of data. And if you would like to build systems where you have machine learning on the edge, like on some small device, then you may have memory limitations and you cannot store all the data. Or there might be privacy issues with data that prevent you from storing the data for a longer time. And so again, this is one of those assumptions that we all take for granted, but that may not be so trivial after all. And so basically in conclusion, it all boils down to the assumption that we live in a static world. We assume that if we collect data, for instance, for doing pedestrian detection or person detection, we can collect data once, we train a model, and then we assume that that model will be valid from then onwards, because the world is static and what the person looks like doesn't change over time. But in practical situations, again, that situation is not true. You have situations where things change over time due to not agreeing with what I say. You have fashion trends, you have seasonal changes and things like that, which means that the appearance of a certain object category may change over time. And that means you have to update your model. That means nowadays that people just say, okay, we retrain the model again. We collect new data and we train the model again. And these assumptions are things that we can easily fulfill when we work in an academic environment, but they are much harder to meet when working in a real world setting. And so what we get is basically this dichotomy, where on the one hand, we have our research bubble, where we publish papers using benchmark data sets. And indeed, we have a perfect setting where all these assumptions are fulfilled. Nothing changes. We can take the whole data set, split it in training, validation, and test, which means that indeed, the test data and the training data are sampled from the exact same distribution, and all is fine. And in that setting, we can develop algorithms and methods that start to work better and better, that reach state-of-the-art performance, sometimes even outperforming humans. But that doesn't necessarily translate to real-world applications. If you look at real-world applications, then training and test data are not coming from the same large pool of data, but they're basically collected separately. First, you collect training data, then you train your model, and then later on, you apply the model on new test data as it becomes available. And so the test data is collected separately from the training data and does not necessarily come from the same distribution. That means that you may have domain shifts, like the illumination may have changed, weather conditions, fashion trends, whatever. It means that also new classes or new tasks may pop up at a later stage where you just suddenly realize that it might be good to also be able to recognize this class or this class, which you didn't think of before. And there's things like concept drift. And all of these are big challenges in real-world applications that are completely missing in the standard research setting that we work on. And so if you compare these two, we see that in our research bubble, overfitting to a particular data set and exploiting data set bias and things like that are really encouraged because they allow you to get an edge over competing methods. But these are not things that are useful in a real world application. In a real world application, you want to have methods that generalize well beyond what you've seen at training stage, that are able to adapt to new situations. And so that's a completely different thing and a completely different view on the problem than what you have in our research environment. And so by making these assumptions explicit, we can see, okay, can we move beyond those assumptions to a setting that might bridge these two bubbles? And that's where the concept of continual learning fits. So this is what the subcommunity in machine learning focusing on continual learning is dreaming of. That is a system that can learn from a stream of data. And so as new data comes in, you analyze the data, you learn from the data, and then you can discard the data, you look at the next few samples. Learning from streaming data means that you can keep on learning. You can keep on improving your models without constraints, and automatically you adapt as there's changes in the environment. You don't need to store all samples. We want to do it without an increase in the memory footprint and in a way that allows to also add new tasks or new labels if needed. And so if we could realize that, we really could get a system that keeps improving over time, just like biological systems do. Biological systems do not store all data they've seen in memory, but they manage to keep on learning and being flexible. And so that's the kind of thing we would like to aim for in the context of continual learning. And by the way, instead of continual learning, you may also have heard other terms that basically refer to the same thing. There's things like incremental learning, lifelong learning, sequential learning. That's basically other terms that maybe put a bit more emphasis on particular aspects, but they're basically doing all the same thing. Now, this is what I dream of in this with this line of research in 5 years, 10 years from now, I don't know. I hope that we can have systems that really can learn just by observing the world around them. Like observing broadcast material, they might learn the link between the speech they hear and the subtitles, and they automatically learn to do speech to text. Or they might recognize patterns in the data, they might learn about the concepts in the images, and so on. And they keep on improving themselves. And that's the key aspect that would really be nice to have. Now, apart from continual learning, there's a lot of other related fields that kind of look at related aspects of this. So there's domain adaptation, there's meta-learning, few-shot learning, out-of-distribution detection. Also, research focusing on causality tries to deal with things like this dataset bias and so on. And there could be a lot of interaction and ideas from one of these flowing into the other. All of them probably should are aiming to move beyond the standard machine learning setting. That's like the default that we have all learned in our basic AI course, but that I think is time to leave, and we should move beyond that. Now, I have here a detailed slide about like how continual learning relates to all these other fields, but for sake of time, I won't discuss this slide in detail here. I guess I can easily talk 10, 15 minutes just about this slide. So I just want to quickly show it to you. What you have here on the left is the standard supervised learning, where indeed we have separately a training stage and a test stage. And you see basically what distributions the data is sampled from and how that changes depending on the setting. If you go to multitasks, if you go to transfer learning, which is probably the thing most of you are most familiar with, if you want to deal with different domains where one is labeled, the other one is unlabeled, then if you want to go to meta learning, online learning, where you basically have a stream of data, and then continual learning, where some of the work, as this as shown here, is still task-based, where you learn one task at a time, whereas others really aim for this stream like you have in the online learning. But again, I know there's too much in this slide to grasp in just 1 minute, but if I go into too much detail here, I won't have time for the rest of my talk. Okay, so this is the setting. Now, you might think at this moment, but what is the issue? If you want to learn from streaming data, just do so. If you have an infinite stream of data, then indeed, maybe you don't need to store the data. You just collect enough data for one batch. You do the stochastic gradient descent. You update your model. You collect the next batch. You do the same thing, and so on. And naively, you might think the only reason why we need to have multiple epochs going over the same data over and over again is simply because we don't have enough data. If you have an infinite amount of data, like an infinite stream, then maybe you just always process new data, and that's fine. The problem is that if you have a stream of data, you have a fundamental issue, and that is what we know as catastrophic forgetting. So basically, what this means is that you will have an overfitting to the most recent data, and you will forget what you have seen earlier. And the only way to tackle that is to make sure that each batch is representative. That's what you get with a standard setting. You take all your data, you shuffle it around, and that means that each batch is IID sampled from the same distribution. And if each sample is IID sampled, then there's no problem. But if you just have a stream of data, then this is not guaranteed. And you may have, like the robot might first be looking at some soap series, and then he sees a lot of images from a particular domain. Then later there is the news, which shows very different images. And this kind of switches, these changes in the distributions that you have in streaming data means that again, you just focus on what you've seen most recently and you forget what you have learned before. And so most of the research on continual learning has really been focused on attacking this basic problem of catastrophic forgetting. And in that setting, people have mostly focused on a task-based setting, like I had in the previous slide, where we have these very drastic changes. You learn one task where the data is sampled from one distribution, and during when you're learning that task, you have access to all the data of that task. Then when you've learned that task, you switch to the next task. And if you have learned that task, you switch to the task after that. And so this task-based setting still can be split up in three different scenarios as proposed in this paper. You can have the task incremental learning, where you really learn one task at a time. And then at test time, you know which data a particular task, a particular sample belongs to. You have the domain incremental learning, where you don't know the task label. And you have the class incremental learning, which is the most difficult one, because you have to also infer the task idea. So just to make that a bit more clear, a lot of the work on continual learning is first tested on very simple data sets, like split MNIST. In split MNIST, the first task is about distinguishing between zeros and one. The second task is about distinguishing between two and three, then between four and five, and so on. In a task incremental setting, you want to learn these different tasks. And at the end, you want the learner to be able to ask this kind of question, where you say, okay, I know this is a four or a five. Can you tell me which of the two it is? So the task is given, and you only need to distinguish between the different classes from that task. So that's still very limited. So that's why people have moved beyond that towards domain incremental learning, where you say, okay, you don't know which task it is. And so basically you have to distinguish between the even and the odd numbers. And then the class incremental learning, where you have to do that. You have to really learn all the different digits and be able to distinguish between all of them, even though you have never learned explicitly to discriminate between a one and a nine, for instance. You've learned zeros versus ones and two versus three, but you need to also be able to cope with these other settings. And so that's obviously more complex because you also have typically a single hat in that setting instead of multiple hats that you have in the task incremental learning. Now we have generalized this setting a bit or proposed an alternative for this standard work that says task incremental, domain incremental, and class incremental. Because on the one hand, we still feel that this idea of what's a task is a bit arbitrary or artificial. Ultimately, you want to just learn from streaming data where you don't have really just one task and then you split to the next task and then you split to the next task. You just want to go with the flow. And to make that distinction, what we've proposed in a recent work is to look at a problem not just based on tasks, not as training validation test, but rather using two different agents. On the one hand, we have the learner who needs to learn new tasks, learn to get better and better at solving these tasks over time in a continual manner. And on the other hand, we have the evaluator who evaluates how good the learner actually performs. And by making this distinction between the learner and the evaluator, you can actually think much more clean about these different settings. So basically, for the learner, you define what its horizon is, how much data the learner can see at any given moment in time. And in a task-based setting, you can say, okay, the learner sees all the data of one data set of one task at a certain time, and then it switches to the next one, then it switches to the next one. but it could also limit your horizon to just a single batch, and then you really have the online learning setting. And the same you can do at the evaluator stage. You can say, okay, what is the distribution shifts that the evaluator encounters? Are they the same as what the learner sees, or are different? And so thinking about this from a learner evaluator point of view is a generalization that allows you to think about things more flexibly than just training, validation, test, or one task, the other task, the other task. And then we add basically on top of task, class, and domain incremental learning, what we refer to as data incremental learning, where the main difference is that indeed, like, we remove, it's basically this task-free setting where you don't have one task at a time, but you just have the data, and it might be different labels popping up as you go. But the learner is not aware of which task he's learning at any given point. He just has to learn everything and deal with new class labels or new domains, new tasks as they come in. And so that's the setting that I will also focus on in the last part of my talk, where I say, okay, what would this, how can we deal with this setting? Before we go there, I just want to give a very brief high-level overview about the research in continual learning so far. So we basically can distinguish three main approaches to tackle domain adaptation. That is, on the one hand, regularization-based methods, where we add extra regularizers that avoid that data from old tasks is forgotten. So that can be things like knowledge distillation, or avoid making changes to parameters that are known to be important for previous tasks. And so these were developed like typically a couple of years ago. In parallel, there were works on parameter isolation methods. There the idea is, what if we reserve part of our model, part of our network, for particular tasks? If we say, okay, this part of the network is dedicated to task one, then we can freeze that part of the network, and by freezing it, we avoid the forgetting. And so that's at the basis of a whole set of methods. You can also make the architecture grow and add new branches as new tasks come in. But they have the main limitation that it only works really if you have this clear definition of tasks and doesn't generalize to these more flexible settings. And then finally, there's replay-based methods, which is basically frustratingly simple, in that the idea is, what if we just keep a small buffer with examples of old data? And we can replay these methods every now and then. And by doing so, by seeing some old samples again every now and then, we can avoid that the model forgets about these. You can do that with explicit samples, or you can do that with samples from a generative model. But that's the basic idea there. And this actually seems to be a very powerful baseline. You would think that using just a few samples from the old tasks, the model would quickly overfit to these few samples and not learn to generalize anymore. But in practice, that's not such a big issue. And just storing a few samples works surprisingly well, and it's kind of the state of the art at this moment, which is kind of frustrating and makes me think, like, we should really find better ways. There must be better things than just storing a few samples in the buffer. And so this is a paper, well, it's probably a bit outdated by now, but that's like a survey we did in the task-based setting, task incremental setting, of methods that people have proposed to date. So that finishes the first part. Now it's time to move on to the second part of my talk, where I zoom in on one particular method we have proposed recently in this context, and we refer to that method as COPE. That's a continual prototype evolution. That's a method for doing continual learning, where the subtitle is learning online from non-stationary data streams. So you really want to go beyond this task-based setting, focusing on the data incremental learning. We want to learn online without storing samples, with a horizon that's really just limited to one batch of data at a time. Even if the data itself is non-stationary, there's like changes in the distribution over time. And so in our experiments, we implement this non-stationarity by switching from one task to another, as you have in a task-based setting. But the main difference is that our model is not aware of these tasks and cannot store or iterate over the data within one task multiple times. We also focus on the specific setting where we might have imbalanced data. So that's something that on non-stationary data streams is often an important issue. You may see a lot of examples that are highly similar for a while, and the balanced data is something that's a luxury you don't have. So we want to see how well we can cope with that. And so we reuse this idea of experience replay because it's just the easiest and it works so well. So here's some related work. For sake of time, I won't go over that. People in the field might recognize these different methods. I should have added the references, but didn't have time for that. Okay, so our COPE method basically has four important components that I will go over in these slides. And as you will see, these are actually pretty simple things. And that's the nice thing of continual learning. It's still a largely unexplored field, and with relatively simple things, you can actually make a difference and move forward. So there's a lot of ground that's still to be explored and to be covered. The first idea that we integrated was to use prototypes. So rather than saying we have a last final classification layer that learns a linear classifier for each task, we say, okay, we work in an embedding space, and in that embedding, each class is represented by a prototype. So that's something that you see often in zero-shot learning or a few-shot learning. And at first you might think that doesn't really make such a big difference, because if I need to compute my distance from a sample to each of these prototypes, the distance being a cosine similarity is basically very similar as evaluating a linear classifier. But the main advantage of using prototypes is the way they are learned. If you have a linear classifier, what you do is you initialize it randomly, and then typically you apply stochastic gradient descent. That means that in very small steps, you start improving it until it's something meaningful. Whereas with prototypes, from the very first sample you have for a given category, you send it through your network, you get a representation for that sample, and you can use that as your prototype. And if your feature extraction works reasonably well because it has been trained previously on other data, then you already have a reasonable classifier just from that one example. And having a good classifier or reasonable classifier is good in two ways. First, you have tried to extract as much information from this one sample as possible, which is important because you cannot revisit the same sample again. You have to discard it because you need to focus on the next samples. And so you need to get as much out of it as you can. And at the same time, because it already gives you a reasonable classifier for your last layer. That means that the gradients that flow back through your feature extraction layers will be smaller. And that's again advantages, because if you would have a very poor linear classifier here, you have very strong gradients that would perturb your feature extraction much more. And these feature extraction layers are shared between the different classes. And so that would affect the classification accuracies on your other classes. So the idea of using prototypes is a really powerful one in this context. And just to explain the whole figure before we move on, to make sure that you're all on the same line. So what we have here on the left is our stream of data. So that's new images coming in on a regular basis. From that stream of data, we collect one batch. So our horizon is limited. So we take like, 10 images and that's it. On top of that, we have a small buffer with our exemplars that we, from old data that we have stored. And so whenever we process a new batch of data to do the forward and back propagation, we take the batch of new samples that comes in and add to that a few samples from our buffer. We extract the features, we compute our loss, we back propagate and so on. And I'll come back to our loss later on. So prototypes are one thing. Now the problem with prototypes is that if you keep your prototypes fixed, if then indeed later you get samples from a different class and you get a loss for that different class back propagated through your network, your representation will change. And if your prototype remains fixed, the prototype will get outdated. So what you need to have is prototypes that basically follow the shift in your representation due to changes in your feature extractions. That's why we do not keep our prototypes fixed, but we have them evolve over time using this simple mechanism where we say each time the prototype is basically a moving average of the prototype we had previously and a new prototype that's computed based on the samples in our batch that belong to that particular category. So whenever we have an old sample here from the buffer, or we encounter a new sample of a particular category, the representation of that category will be used to update our prototypes. And so our prototypes move along with the data, which is important and which is different from the way it's typically done in the literature. There have been a couple of papers who used prototypes, but then typically they keep the prototypes fixed until you have trained an entire task. And then at the end of the task, then you say, okay, now let's see how we can update all our prototypes. But that doesn't work in a data incremental fashion where you don't have these task boundaries or you don't know them. And that's also suboptimal because it means that at the beginning, when you start learning a new task, your prototypes might be representative, but then after a while, if your representations get updated, your feature extraction is updated, the prototypes may no longer be a good match. And so by doing it like this, in each iteration, we update our prototypes, both the new ones and the old ones, we avoid that issue. So that's an important key of our method. Something else we did is to make sure that our replay is balanced. So the data is non-stationary, but we assume that ultimately we want all classes are equally important. And so we want to ultimately get a performance that's as good as possible on balanced data. So our evaluation works in a balanced setting. And so to that end, when we need to decide which samples to store in our buffer, we make sure that things are balanced. And that way we can sample from the buffer and we can make sure that, well, maybe we don't see all the classes in each batch, but we regularly see the same classes again, and the evolving prototypes indeed keep up to date. And then there's a final thing that maybe some of you may have already wondered, that's like this more complex part here in the middle of our figure, that is, when computing our loss, we don't only look at the prototypes themselves, but we also look at the individual samples in our batch. And so we define a loss that on the one hand says like, okay, our new representation should be close to the prototype of the matching class and far from the prototypes of the non-matching classes. But at the same time, it should also be close to other features from the same same class in our batch and far from other features, other samples from different classes in the same batch. And so based on these other samples in the batch, we define what we call proxy prototypes or pseudo prototypes. And in our loss, we use them like next to the actual prototypes. And that way we get a better balance. And so quickly over some results. So I already mentioned the split MNIST data set. Similar to split MNIST, you can also split other data sets. And so often used data sets are split cipher 10 or split cipher 100. And you see here like a lot of competing methods. So if you would train offline where you have all the data available simultaneously, that's of course an upper bound of what you can get in this more difficult streaming fashion. And that's the highest numbers in the tables. A more fair comparison would be to compare with an IID online setting where you basically train only for one epoch. So you have all the data, you can shuffle it so that each batch is really IID sampled from all the data, but you only do one pass over the data. And that means that the number is lower. On MNIST, you still have relatively large amounts of data, so the difference is small, but on Cypher, the differences get bigger. And so this is a more realistic upper bound than the full offline case. Fine-tuning shows a catastrophic forgetting. If you don't do anything special, things fail drastically, but different methods for continual learning that have been proposed in the literature manage to avoid that catastrophic forgetting to a large extent. And so does our methods, where we're still at least as good or slightly better depending on the data set. And so these methods actually works pretty well over a range of different data sets, but especially also keeps performing well if we switch to unbalanced data streams. So if we don't have the same amount of data of each class, but you have like 10 times more data of one class at some point, and then later it switches, then we see that the performance of lots of these methods drop, whereas the COPE still gets significantly better results. So the way we deal with this non-stationarity means that we are much more robust to unbalanced data streams. And that's not only due to this balanced replay, but also due to the proxy loss that we are using and the way it all fits together. And so finally, we visualized the representations. And so you see that if we use this new loss, the categories have somewhat larger boundaries or margins between them, and we get better performance than if you don't, if you would just use the standard prototypical loss. And so then it's time for me to wrap up, I think. So basically my main take home message for all of you is rethink the standard machine learning paradigm. It sounds so trivial at first, and we all take it for granted, but it works in our nice research bubble where we work on benchmark data sets, and it can really solve data sets pretty well. But when you go to the real world, it might be a different thing. And so there we have a lot of additional challenges that need to be addressed, and that probably may have a much bigger impact in practice than just getting like 1% extra on a particular benchmark in this kind of limited setting that we have created for ourselves. And so open challenges in this context, I believe, is first like, yeah, can we get rid of this experience replay? Can we do better than that, that we don't have to store any samples? Because for instance, for privacy reasons, that might be an issue. And somehow you would feel that the same information should also be encoded in the model already somewhere. So can we get that out? Also, I think we need to have a deeper understanding of the actual learning processes. So everything like stochastic gradient descent, cross entropy loss, all these things have actually been developed for this standard setting where you have IID data, where everything is static. Now we move away from that and we actually have to rethink these things, and we need to dive in and try to better understand what is the effect of really one step. Is there something better we can do that's more robust, that generalized better, and so on. And so that could bring us to real world use cases. And if indeed we can show that you can keep on improving over time as you process more and more data, that would be really a powerful realization. And with that, I conclude my talk, and then now we have time for questions.